15 drivers started the FARC-Off with the hopes of making it to Texas World and locking up the FARC Smash Beer Low Dollar Series Championship, and after a wild doubleheader at Grand Detour, 5 drivers were eliminated, leaving only 10 to do it all over again for the next 3 weekends. Bob Steffens and Mark Thompson locked themselves into the round of 10 at Grand Detour with their victories. For Bob Steffens, the victory lane celebration was especially sweet because he had finally scored his first Smash Beer Low Dollar Series win after 10 years in the series. Lev Azaroff, Bradley Carlisle, Kevin Monroe, Tristan Kristoff for Team Burr, amazingly enough, Johnson Clapp and Chuck Johnson all got in due to their points positions, and then Joshua Pacer and Todd Stater round out the round of 10 due to their average finishes during the round of 15. And now we go trackside for the start of the round of 10, the Schiller Auto Center's 100 at the DuQuoin State Fairgrounds. Taylor Brillen grabs the Carl's P1 award and will lead the field to the green flag here at the DuQuoin State Fairgrounds. Gio Aria started on the outside, and as the field pours through turn one, he's going to hang on and lead the first lap of the race. Kelly Splicen on lap two, and Bradley Carlisle, FARC-Off contender, find themselves in the turn one wall. The track has been very slick all day, and I have a feeling they're not going to be the last victims of that. Chuck Johnson becomes a victim of mechanical problems. The FARC-Offer brings his car to the pit lane and will lose a lap. A round of pit stops before a lap 15 restart puts Riley Durbin up at the front, but the very next lap, John Burr's going to take a scary ride in turn one, flipping several times. And that's a shame for John Burr, who struggles with funding and often speed, but he's a crowd pleaser nonetheless. Another FARC-Offer, Mark Thompson, cycles to the front after we had a few more takers on pit road. He's going to grab himself a few valuable bonus points. But fellow FARC-Offer Bob Steffens is going to blow his engine off at turn four. Billy Bob Childers clips him and goes flying into the inside wall as well. And that's going to take both the 16 and the 7 out of the race. But as Steffens finds himself in a hole, Bradley Carlisle has dug himself out of the hole he fell into when he spun on lap two. He cycles into the lead with fellow FARC-Offer Johnson Clapp right behind him. Mark Thompson becomes another FARC-Off casualty as he has a suspension failure, and the 64 team is going to have to pull that car behind the wall. So that puts both of the Quincy winners out of the race. Tristan Kristoff and Lev Azaroff, two more FARC-Offers, get together. Kristoff in the second team Burr car goes spinning to the inside and just kisses the inside wall. He's going to keep going. And now even more trouble for the FARC-Offers as Johnson Clapp gets speared by Billy Ray Smith Thompson and goes into the wall, but both those cars are going to keep going. Oh, Trek Togger gets a little piece of that, wanting to join in on the fun as well. Trek Togger's been in the wall a couple times already today. Lap 50, the halfway point, Kenny Brillen and Dan Miato now find themselves dueling for the lead. And as that's going on, Joshua Pacer falls a lap down after having to change a flat tire. We're only at the halfway point now, and already a lot of terrible luck has bitten the championship contenders. Dan Mayato now finds himself in the lead after the restart. Chuck Johnson in that black 46 car is still looking to make up a couple of laps. The battle for fifth is on between Lev Azaroff and Kevin Monroe, two of the FARC-Off contenders, with Kenny George in the 50 right behind them. But George is going to slide up into the turn three wall, and now he's going to do several rolls. That's just going to add insult to injury as he was eliminated from the FARC-Off last week. All of this attrition, especially among the FARC-Offers, is putting Tristan Kristoff in the 68 in a very comfortable position. He has just made his way up to 13th. And because this is the only race that he has scheduled during the round of 10, he's going to need every position he can get to get into the final five on the average finish, while Trek Togger does several rolls in turn one, his race finally coming to an end after several incidents. Lap 72, Riley Durbin slides up into the wall, and he's going to collect Monica Rook. Riley Durbin's day going downhill after he led some laps early on. Jim Kidd in car 18 is marching his way to the front as we approach 20 laps to go, challenging Lev Azaroff for second place around the outside. And if his car can hold out, this will be shaping up to be Jim Kidd's best run in the FARC Smash Beer Low Dollar Series, but Lev Azarov, as he tries to chase him back down, gets up into the turn one wall and does several rolls, so the FARC-Off contenders are not done getting themselves into trouble. Meanwhile, Dan Mayato, who has dominated the second half of this race, is going to have to pull his car behind the wall and drop out, taking both Freya and Saito cars out after Trek Togger's troubles earlier today. But this is going to put Jim Kidd in the lead with just 14 laps to go. Kevin Monroe trying to chase him down and grab himself the win, getting himself into the final five of Texas World. But Allie Riggs in the 919 is going to have other plans. Allie Riggs has been racing in the Mudstars Dirt Late Models this season, and you can see that experience paying off as she sails around the outside to grab second place, setting her sights on Jim Kidd, as Monroe now loses control of the 63 and goes flipping down turn one. It really seems that the racing gods are out for blood against the FARC-Offers today, but picking up the pieces would be Jim Kidd as he holds off Allie Riggs and sails down the front stretch to claim his first FARC Smash Beer Low Dollar Series victory. And that's going to be the first win this season for Power Surge America as well. Three FARC-Offers finishing in the top 10 today. Johnson Klepp, Bradley Carlisle, and Tristan Kristoff, who picked his way through the carnage and grabbed a 10th place finish for Team Burr. That is really going to help his average finish if he can't get a ride for the remaining races of the round of 10. And how about a shout out to Gio Arias, who brings home his first top 10 since Darlington and his first top 5 since Road America the week before. Troy Peterson also bringing home a very good finish in 11th place in the Dale Clough car. Kevin Monroe crashed with only a few laps remaining, but he still comes home in 19th, so he's gonna salvage a few points there. Next, we move on to the Fairground Speedway in Nashville, Tennessee, for the running of the Prism River 150. Billy Bob Childers picks up Power Surge America's momentum with the Carl's P1 Award at Nashville. Outside pole sitter Monica Rook falls way back as Childers pulls away, and for the second week in a row, Bradley Carlisle is bitten by early race troubles as his car stalls on the backstretch, collecting several others, including Zach Gott and Lev Azarov. But unlike last week, he will not get the car going again, and Carlisle drops out of the race early, undoing what he gained with his fifth place finish at DuQuoin. Chuck Johnson is off to a better start tonight than last week, making his way up to 10th place despite rubbing fenders with Stanley Parsons. Jeff Wilkins, car 78, goes up and over the top of Jim Kidd. Luckily, Wilkins is going to keep going. I would praise American Steel, but these FARC composite bodies are made of plastic. After a round of pit stops, Bob Steffens finds himself in the lead. Chuck Johnson and Mark Thompson, fellow FARC offers, second and third. And that 79 car is Johnson Klepp, who got a last-minute deal with Ken Groves Racing in Jeff Wilkins' backup car. Johnson Klepp tries to make his way back onto the lead lap as Bob Steffens has a problem and brings the 7 car into the pit lane. And unfortunately, for the second week in a row, he will not return to the track. So Bob Steffens finds himself in an even deeper hole as Joshua Pacer tries to dig himself out of the hole that he fell into at DuQuoin by picking up the race lead. But Pacer's gonna pit on the next caution, putting Chuck Johnson in the race lead. That is not Joshua Pacer in front of Johnson. That is Aubrey Wood in the Desert Star car with the Fast Track sponsorship left over from Joshua Pacer's stint in that car. Speaking of Pacer, he brings that car back into the pit lane, and he's going to lose a lap. So another tough break for Pacer, who finds his final five chances slipping away. Couple backmarkers getting caught up in a wreck. Michael Day and Troy Peterson in the double zero. And what is Troy Peterson doing? He just drives right up into the path of Ricky McKenzie in the 462 this week. Danica Hollifield mixing it up for the lead with Chuck Johnson and Stanley Parsons finds herself in the wall. But she's not giving up as she dives right into turn three and catches right back up like nothing happened. Stanley Parsons extends his lead a little bit, but he smacks the wall now. And Danica Hollifield, car 25, drives right back around. But now we've got another caution on lap 72 as Johnson Klepp gets turned around by Tyron Key. But Klepp and Key are gonna keep going. Timothy Ruiz making his second series start, finds himself in the lead on lap number 77 with FARC-Offers Todd Stater and Mark Thompson right behind him. But another caution and round of pit stops will put Taylor Brillin in the lead on a lap 86 restart. And that's Danica Hollifield making her way back to the front, looking to put the pressure on the 9. Billy Ray Smith-Thompson holds fourth place, and Chuck Johnson is going to want it. But Smith-Thompson is going to be focused on just getting good results from here after being eliminated from the FARC-Off. Kevin Monroe goes for a spin and loses several positions after running into the back of Troy Peterson. And look out! That is Stan Coleman, I believe, in the 40, taking out Taylor Brillin from the lead. Danica Hollifield drives right on by to take the top spot. But Brillin is going to keep going and even hangs on to second place. They were so far ahead of the field. But a round of pit stops is going to put Billy Ray Smith-Thompson in the lead. Lev Azarov goes around after a bunch of cars run out of real estate coming off of turn number 2. But Azarov's going to keep going even after the pounding that car has taken today. Timothy Ruiz falls back and gets himself into a wreck. He tries to get going, but here comes Lev Azarov running right into the back of the 112, sending him for a roll. And that's going to take the both of them out. Mark Thompson gets pretty tired of Tom Brayton and puts him and Tyron Key up into the wall. And just as Joshua Pacer thinks he's going to get away, Taylor Brillin and Stan Coleman put him into the wall and onto his roof. And for the second week in a row, Joshua Pacer goes out of the race. Once again, it seems like a lot of the FARC-Offers are going to be having trouble, and the other guys are going to be picking up the pieces as Stanley Parsons takes the lead. Chuck Johnson and Johnson Clapp fight for second place. And Clapp's going to have no trouble getting by the 46 despite a little bit of interference from the 41 of Zach Webster. Todd Stater running sixth is going to have his championship hopes take a hit, as well as Kevin Munroz, as Stater gets caught up with Tom Brayton in the 100. And then he finds himself in more trouble after the restart, getting caught up with Danica Hollifield, Monica Rook, and Mark Thompson. Stater doesn't have a whole lot of damage to his car, fortunately, but he has lost several spots in those incidents. Stanley Parsons hits the wall once again. He's been trying to knock down the walls all night, and that gives Johnson Clapp the opportunity to get under the 427. Chuck Johnson follows through to second place, and Johnson Clapp takes over the race lead, and it's going to be smooth sailing for Johnson Clapp, who wasn't even sure if he was going to be racing tonight until Ken Groves extended a helping hand. Johnson Clapp takes the checkered flag and punches his ticket to the final five. He'll be going to Texas World with a shot at the title. Gio Arias brings home his second top three in a row, but it may be too little too late for the former Super Series champion. Perhaps he could have been up there in the FARC-Off if he had shown that speed earlier in the season. Speaking of which, Chuck Johnson comes home in fifth place, bringing home a decent amount of points. Mark Thompson 10th. Todd Stater salvages an 11th place finish, but down in 16th, Kevin Monroe finishes outside the top 15 once again. So Monroe is really going to have to pick it up at Talladega. And we've got a couple other of the small teams getting some good finishes. Troy Peterson and Tom Brayton, 17th and 18th. And Jeff Wilkins comes home 19th after flipping the 78 car. And now we will move on to the final doubleheader of the season, the Empire Rent-A-Car Duels at Talladega. And as with the other doubleheaders, here are the rules. You start race one, and if you finish, you move on to race two. If you don't finish race one, the drivers who failed to qualify will take your spots for race two. So if you're a FARC-Offer and you drop out while your championship rivals move on, that's going to be very costly. Coming all the way from Dash Cup, Vincenzo Focosato for Focus Auto Sports grabs the Carl's P1 award, but outside pole sitter Mike Malone is going to push ahead on the outside as the field pours through turns 1 and 2, but Mike Malone's got a problem already on lap 1. He brings the car to the inside with a suspension failure, and he will drop out just as quickly as his race began. Mark Thompson also had to bring his car into the pits at the end of lap 1, but he's going to return to the track and now faces the threat of going a lap down. But if he survives this race, he'll be able to move on to race number two and keep his championship hopes alive. But we've got a pileup breaking out at the exit of turn two. Vincenzo Focasado, the pole sitter involved, as well as two of the FARC-Offers, Todd Stater and Joshua Pacer. Taylor Brillen took a hard shot in the side from Riley Durbin, who almost made it through. We got a slow motion overhead shot of how this started. And it looks like a whole bunch of cars on the inside are just converging on the same spot. And something had to give. I see Lev Azarov at the start of that. He got some slight damage from that. Riley Durbin just threads his way between Todd Stater and Ben Atkins, another one of the Dash Cup drivers who've come over for this race. On board with Riley Durbin now. He almost makes it through. Gets past Joshua Pacer, but Taylor Brillen appears in front of him. Todd Stater got some damage to the front end, and that contact with the 9 is going to do him in. A huge, huge heartbreak for Todd Stater, who might have been able to get that damage repaired had he not hit anyone else. But after swapping the points lead with Kenny George all the way up until the FARC-Off, Stater's championship hopes are effectively done. Kira Smith in car 89 leads on the restart in the third Accelerator Motorsports car. But the field isn't done getting bunched up as Mark Thompson and Bradley Carlisle find themselves in a four-wide situation. Mark Thompson goes spinning, and he gets plowed by Kurt Walker, Johnson Clapp, and Kevin Monroe. Also involved, Dan Legleiter and Zach Webster. Hard hits to those cars. Johnson Clapp trying to get away, gets smashed by Zach Gott there. But Johnson Clapp, as you remember, locked himself into the final five last week with his victory at Nashville. So he's safe, but Bradley Carlisle is done with a blown engine. And Mark Thompson is done for the day and done for the year, too, after that wreck. With his championship rivals faltering, Bob Steffens, who leads on this restart and picks up a few bonus points, is going to try to get his championship hopes back on track. But we get another caution at the halfway point, lap 19, as Kelly Spicen gets turned around by Billy Bob Childers. Kevin Monroe goes a lap down on lap 28, coming to 10 laps to go. That damage he received in an earlier wreck is certainly slowing him down, but he's going to try to finish this race so he can repair his car, move on to race two. Kira Smith leads a group of four cars behind the main pack, and Joshua Pacer is among this group, so he's on track to finish in the top 15, despite getting involved in that lap 4 crash. Aaron Singer's got a problem and has to bring his car into the pit lane. After running in the top 10 all day, Singer's gonna go a lap down. Lev Azarov falls behind after taking a little bit of damage as well, but he's still in the top 15. Truman Ellison's almost gonna get turned around by Dan Mayato. Now, Truman Ellison has been running very well. He's sticking with the lead pack. Still on the lead lap. It's a pleasant surprise to see Ellison running up front after he's struggled for speed for most of his FARC career. Trek Togger running in the lead, almost gets taken out by a bump from Danica Hollifield. Togger is going for his first oval victory, but now he's got to contend with the lapped car of Chuck Johnson, who seems to be down on power. But Johnson still running in the top 20, 17th place. Johnson just has to bring the car home so the team can figure out what's going on and get it ready for race two. Three laps to go. Max Hollifield in the 777, the third SWH Racing car, finds himself in the lead, but Monica Rook holds him up and breaks up what could have been a 10-12 car fight for the win. Danica Hollifield and Trek Togger get away with the lead. Dan Mayato and Anthony Griffith follow. It's a four-car battle now, coming to two laps to go. But what's this? Togger's slowing down, and so are several other cars. I think these guys are running out of fuel. That's about seven cars diving into the pits, coming to just two laps to go. So is there anyone who can make it? Danica Hollifield has a huge lead. She's slowing down as well, making her way to the pit lane. Jack Ashcroft and Kenny George follow. But we've got one car still on the track, going for it. Truman Ellison takes the lead, and he has taken the white flag. Aaron Singer, the 62, is a lap down. He's not a factor. Truman Ellison brought a brand new engine to this race. Hopefully the sponsor on his hood, Genuine Stolen Parts, is not an implication of where it came from. Regardless, it's serving him very nicely. Truman Ellison cruises through the tri-oval and takes the checkered flag, his first FARC Smash Beer Low Dollar Series victory in a stunning upset reminiscent of John Burr's victory against Chuck Johans here 20 years ago. Kira Smith comes across the line several seconds behind to finish second, and Billy Bob Childers comes home in third. What a day for the minnows of the sport, as Truman Ellison takes the checkered flag, and Tom Brayton brings the racing team car home in 12th. But as for the FARC-Off, Bob Steffens was the highest finisher among them in 11th. Chuck Johnson, Kevin Monroe, Lev Azarov, and Joshua Pacer will be the only championship contenders to move on to race 2. Thanks to his victory earlier in the day, Truman Ellison will lead the field to the green flag, but he's got a problem right off the line. The 03 takes a very, very long time to get going as everybody on the outside just blows by him. Kira Smith jumps out to the early lead, and Truman Ellison at the end of lap 1 falls all the way down to 27. I wonder if he dropped a cylinder or something like that between the end of this race and the start of this one. Anthony Griffith had a problem, had to bring his car in at the end of lap 1, and he's going to go a lap down. Now this is interesting. I wonder if Truman Ellison's speed went directly to Tom Brayton, who now powers around the outside of Kira Smith and takes the lead in a car that really has no business being up there, though the racing team also announced that they brought a new engine to this race and that they'll be using at Texas World as well. Stanley Parsons takes a trip into the wall after Max Chavillon made contact with Dan Maiato, and David Labarde just comes flying in there, not paying any attention whatsoever. Both Parsons and Labarde took quite a while to get out of their cars. Hopefully they'll be all right. Monica Rook takes the lead. Hopefully she'll be faster in this race, but we got another caution and restart. A round of pit stops cycles Joshua Pacer out into the lead. He's going to grab some bonus points for the FARC-Off. Working lap 20, just past the halfway point in what is shaping up to be a much tamer race too. But we've got a bit of a problem with Jason Bates and Aaron Singer, thanks to Kevin Monroe. Kevin Monroe taking out his teammate Singer there. But I'll bet Monroe's getting a little antsy. His championship hopes are on life support at this point. Joshua Pacer continues to lead. I see Bob Steffens running up, trying to get into the top five there. Anthony Griffith takes a bit of a ride down onto the apron. The right side of that 07 car is not looking too good, but he's going to try to get going again. Azarov slowing down on the front stretch. Lev Azarov's got a problem with just a few laps to go in this race, and he's going to have to drop out. Azarov's championship hopes are done after a terrible, terrible round of 10 for him. Two laps to go now. Bob Steffens hangs on to the lead, but not for long. Here comes Max Chavillon, car 51, on the inside. Jim Kidd follows. Kidd out of the final corner, slowing down. Jim Kidd's got a problem. It's going to be clear sailing for Max Chavillon as the field tries to catch him, but there's not enough time. Max Chavillon comes across the line to take his first FARC Smash Beer Low Dollar Series victory. Another first-timer today. Bob Steffens and Chuck Johnson, with their 6th and 7th place finishes, grab themselves a ton of points, but will it be enough to get them into the final 5? Truman Ellison recovered to finish in 10th place, and we've got a few other guys down in the order that you normally don't see up there. Billy Bob Bradburn in the Team Burr 68 in 10th place, John Burr himself in 16th, Barry Woods in the Stan Coleman car 17th, Harv Henry and Tom Brayton, 18th and 19th. And now that the round of 10 is wrapped up, we shall give you the 5 drivers who will duke it out for the FARC Smash Beer Low Dollar Series Championship at Texas World. Johnson Klepp, Chuck Johnson, Joshua Pacer, Tristan Kristoff, and Bob Steffens. 3 rookies, a second-year driver, and a 10-year veteran. Johnson Klepp punched his ticket with his victory at Nashville. Chuck Johnson and Joshua Pacer got in on points. And Tristan Kristoff and Bob Steffens make it on their average finish. Kristoff with his 10th place finish at DuQuoin, and Bob Steffens with his average finish of 18.8 through all 4 races of the round of 10. These 5 drivers now only have 1 requirement to take home the 2016 FARC Smash Beer Low Dollar Series Championship. Beat the other 4 at Texas World Speedway. And you can catch all the action right here on the FARC Racing Network.